coming up on this episode of Outlook TV. Poodle opens in Victoria.
Quanah Style talks about her roots in a music video for Savage.
Victoria Pride online, and much, much more. Hello and welcome to Outlook TV. I'm Rebecca Wyman.
And I'm Ollie, and you're watching Outlook TV, the queer magazine newscast that brings you the story that matter the most from coast to coast.
We're going to kick it off in Vancouver with, a story you covered, Ollie.
I did. It's with Quanah Style, and we went to Celebrities Nightclub for the premiere of Canada's Drag Race. Hey guys, it's me, it's Ollie, and we are back on the streets. And you know what's giving me life? Well, Quanah Style and her brand new EP, Savage. I'm about to talk with Quanah about her latest release right here on the streets of Vancouver.
I'm a proud Indigenous transgendered woman. I grew up on a very small reserve. I had a lot stronger upbringing from my culture than I think a lot of people from my generation would have, because both of my parents are Cree. That's the tribe we come from. My dad is Bush Cree, or Napoleon, and my mom is from Pawmakers Reserve. And so they speak different dialects, but they were both of my parents were raised by their grandparents. So I definitely feel like they had a stronger upbringing in their culture than somebody else from their generation, which is something they passed down to me. And I grew up with my culture. I grew up as a little boy in a very small, remote northern community, and I spent about a solid year of my life in a place called Small Boys Camp that is a cultural revitalization community. So that really instilled integrity in me for my heritage and for my culture. And I actually just got given my new traditional name in Cree, which in Cree is Wapigahel Esquel Gawia Upahoot, which translates to white eagle woman taking flight. And it meant a lot to me because the last time I had a traditional name given to me was when I was a 5-year-old little boy. And that name translates to energetic northern lights, which I think is so fitting for me. So to be able to have my adult name and have myself as a fully realized woman with the backing of my mom and my culture behind me, giving me that support and empowerment means the world to me.
Can you hear that? Drama.
January 3rd, the Quanah Style, the full feature-length album came out on Wet Tracks, and I followed it up with Savage. So actually, on my album, Give Me Life was produced by Diana Boss, the big video I did. So I'm so happy to team up with them again for my latest EP that came out called Savage. I wanted to reclaim the word in a sense of ownership and pride when it can be used in a derogatory manner. I had a normal music video planned for it, and then when COVID hit, it wasn't a possibility. Like, so many queens showed up for me, went to bat, learned my words, so we shot a social distance music video for Savage. So it really meant the world to me to have so many queens that I love and respect and admire go to bat for me and be part of something while we all couldn't be together. It was a way to unify us and stand in solidarity for our community.
Like in the dress I wore, slipping me his digits on the dance floor.
Three things that are giving me life are Ilona Verley, Scarlett Verley, and fried chicken, bitch, let's eat!
Make sure that you stream Quanah's music on all of your favorite music streaming devices. For Outlook TV, this is Ollie in Vancouver.
And next up, we're going to head to Victoria for A Vicious Poodle.
Well, actually, a lot of people are into puppies, and this is the brand new queer space in Victoria.
Sounds great. Let's check it out.
Hi, I am here at Victoria's newest queer venue, the Vicious Poodle Pub. And we're going to go grab some food, check out a couple of Victoria's premier drag artists in a show, and find out what everyone is loving about this place. And with social distancing still in place, we're going to do it all safely. Let's go check it out.
Welcome to the Vicious Poodle.
You know, I used to live in New York City and I ran gay bars there, and I lived in a gay neighborhood and worked in a gay bar, and there were a lot of gay restaurants around, queer people everywhere, local drag artists, all kinds of great performers, and I got to live in this little alternate universe, this sort of alternate reality. And I wanted to create the same sort of a situation here, a space that is ours, where being gay is, or queer is, the norm, and everything else is sort of outside. And when you step through these doors, You're in this sort of little alternate universe inside of Victoria. So when May came along, and it looked like there was actually going to be a possibility for us to open, it was such a relief. And I'm so glad to get the community in here and fill the space with life.
Hello, Outlook TV!
So amazing and great about this place is that it is a gay pub. This is an inclusive space. It's a welcoming space for all different genders and sexualities. And it's not just like a bar scene in that way. It's a pub scene. It's food and socializing and beautiful atmosphere. Yeah, so many great things about it. The great thing about this place too is really the fact that we can have entertainment. There's gonna be a drag show tonight. So excited about that. And I know that the owner, Socrates, is really excited to have more entertainment and more arts that is really geared towards the LGBTQ plus scene. And I'm really excited for that as well.
Hello, Outlook TV.
I like this place because it's not only a queer bar, but you can have brunch and then you can watch drag shows, and brunch and drag shows are my two favorite things in this world. Do I need to say more? No. So I'm a drag queen and I'll be performing next week on Tuesday with my good sister Henrietta Dubé, and my name is Honey Do Me.
Obviously with COVID, everything shut down, and so this is literally the only place in the city you can see drag at the moment. And it's really cool because everyone finally respects your physical space. The fried chicken's really good, the pork dumplings are really good, the quinoa fritters are really good. They have this beautiful bowl, like a salad quinoa bowl that they call a Les Bowl, which I just recommend to everyone because it's fun to say. And you'll see me, Henrietta Dubé, every other Tuesday and every Saturday serving brunch in full drag.
This has been an incredible night. Definitely check out The Vicious Poodle here on Johnson Street in Victoria. This has been Kelly Legg with Outlook TV.
It's time for us to take a little break now.
And you know what we should do during pandemic pride, Rebecca?
What should we do?
Well, we should organize Outlook TV watch parties.
I'm in. Let's do it.
Let's do it.
Welcome back. You're watching Outlook TV.
And now we're going to see what's in store at Vancouver Queer Film Festival this year.
Like everything else, it's a COVID year.
Ooh.
Who knows what's up?
Like festivals all over the world, the Vancouver Queer Film Festival is going virtual this year. Join us as we go behind the scenes to find out what they have planned for 2020.
This year for the VQFF is still here, and I actually came up with that theme early on in the year before COVID really hit us full force, because the film submissions and all of the research I was doing for films that were already traveling the film festival circuit, and so still here really felt like ultimately the thing that a lot of these filmmakers were getting at.
Village is another world inside a world.
Homeless youth come to this area because this is what we know.
Pier Kids is our opening gala film, and it is a stunning documentary. It follows a group of Black, queer, and trans youth who meet each other and find community and family on the Christopher Street Piers, which historically has been a very queer spot in New York City.
I will cover you with love when I next see you.
The Centerpiece Gala film is another really, really excellent film directed by, written by, and starring a trans woman, Isabel Sandoval, who's Filipina. And it follows her main character is an undocumented trans Filipina woman living in the United States, in New York. She's working as a caregiver for an elderly woman.
Tomorrow, let's go.
Wrestling found me. I love it.
Come on.
15
seconds. We always make sure that we spotlight queer youth in our programming. And this year we have a youth gala film called Changing the Game, which is a documentary, and it follows three young trans athletes in the United States as they advocate for themselves to participate in the sports that they love with the same gender that they identify with.
Start fresh.
You know I can't work out during Ramadan. I get headaches.
We'll be closing the festival with a film called Breaking Fast, and it's a queer Muslim romantic comedy, which I never thought those were words that I would get to say out loud, and I'm so happy that I get to. It's a really, really great, lighthearted, but also very genuine and deep film.
Office ashilam. Night duty.
We are online August 13th to 23rd, but we didn't want to become a kind of queer Netflix because that's not what we are. We're a community-driven festival, and so we want it to feel like people are gathered together. So people will be able to watch films within a 3-hour time span of their allotted slot time. And that's why it was also really important for us to still have our parties in some kind of digital form and for us to still be doing Q&As with our filmmakers so that people can still feel like they're engaging with these artists.
You deserve to be loved.
For Outlook TV, this is Angus Pratt in Vancouver.
Oh, Rebecca, I love a good story, and I love Pride.
Oh, queer history, it's the best. Let's go to North Van and check out a panel of people talking about just that.
Hi guys, it's me, it's Ollie, and guess what? For the very first time at Vancouver Pride, Charmin De Silva is bringing the Vancouver Queer History Panel, where six members of the community are going to tell their stories about being queer in Vancouver during different times in living memory. Outlook TV was there on a day where they filmed the panel. Let's check it out.
I got off the bus on Granville and Davie, and I walk up to Howe, and then walk down to Helmkin, and then get back to Granville, and then that was it. That was all my four squares, five times. And I was like, is this what Gay Village is? Oh my God.
You know, as Vancouver Pride moves its events virtual this year through the celebration, I think there is a real focus on education about our history.
Two things that we did in those early years. One was that there was this tree towards the end of the parade route that we called Dyke Tree. And we would, at the end of the parade, there would be 30, 40 of us sitting under this tree at the end of the parade route, eating, laughing, drinking, playing music. So I think of that as a big chunk of my pride.
Right now, there's such a spotlight on activism and protest as a part of Pride. And an important part of that is understanding where Pride came from in a Vancouver context. So often when we talk about the history of Pride, it's American queer history. We talk about Stonewall. But there is so much important queer history that has happened right in our own backyard with people who have shaped what Vancouver is today and what our queer community here in Vancouver is today.
You walk up the stairs to the Quadra, there's a big black cat that says restricted. We know we're in the right place. We're going to find out if we are lesbians. We open the doors. It's a black-lit room with a bunch of tables with beer bottles with candles stuck in them with that red terry towel I've been around the bar forever covering on it. The washroom didn't have a door. The bar was a couple of coolers. The DJ was up on a raised stage on a table that had one of those record players where when you take the top off, it becomes the speaker. So you can't dance really too close to the table. And we looked around the room, and I thought, there's a lot of leather in this room. There's a lot of really short hair. There's a lot of very tough-looking women.
And suddenly we heard this noise, and we saw some shopping carts coming down the street and some people with banners and placards down by Alexander Park. And I think it might have been one of the very first Pride parades. And we said, what is this all about? And so that was very exciting. So when we actually finally moved to Vancouver, Pride was something we attended every year.
There has been such a focus on the importance of queer history and having that conversation in the Vancouver context. So doing this first event is very exciting. But the good news is that it's not over after this one panel and this one event. Our hope is to be able to have these conversations, more of these conversations in the future.
you can check out the Vancouver Queer History panel from the comfort of your living room. For Outlook TV, this is Ollie in Vancouver.
Hey Ollie, are you doing everything you can do to be a good ally?
Well, I'm trying, but I know that Carmela Labar is about to tell me everything I need to know.
Perfect.
What's up, Canada? Thank you for watching Outlook TV. My name is Lira Wen. Today we have a little post-COVID interview for you with one of my favorite people on this entire planet. We have activist, educator, and performer, the incomparable Carmela Labar.
Doing Vancouver's Next Drag Superstar would really propel me into the drag scene, and it did. It was quite wild, but I got to learn a lot about myself in a very limited amount of time. You don't always get an opportunity to get to do something that you really resonate with, and luckily I found drag, even though I have done things like acting and dancing and things like that before. I found that drag really helped me come into my own just in terms of confidence and just being able to meet new people. During the lockdown has been quite wild, and it's been an experience for me because it's funny because I'm just used to going to the bar, practice a song, go to the bar, do it and have fun with my friends. So it's kind of interesting that now I need to set up like a studio in my room, like I have a green screen, things like that. I purposely tried to do my best with this, but that's why I rely on doing live videos, like live streams, because it was more of an authentic experience because people could comment with me and I could do songs that people might request if I knew them. But I have started to do more videos and things like that. But a few years ago, Kendall and I created a show called Visible in Vancouver, and it was to highlight performers of color in general. Kendall opened it up to some of our American siblings as well, and all of the proceeds went to Black Lives Matter.
But I won't. Some look for trouble, while others don't.
I like to think of myself as an ally. I know I've stumbled a few times with being an ally to Indigenous people and to my trans siblings and things like that. But that's what allyship is. There's many buzzwords going around like virtue signaling, white privilege, white fragility, things like that. Just give it a quick little Google. A tier of allyship is first maybe ask a friend, what is a good place for me to start my research? But yeah, I do think it's important for you to intrinsically be like, I'm gonna make a conscious decision to take my knowledge into my own hands and not rely fully on my POC counterpart.
I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise.
And from my home to yours, thank you for watching Outlook TV. My name is Lira Wen.
Oh, I love summer, Rebecca. Don't you love it?
I do, but should we go take a little break? Is it getting too hot?
Well, it's always hot when Out TV is on.
Welcome back. You're watching Outlook TV.
Hey, Rebecca, did you know that both Ottawa, Calgary, and Vancouver Pride presented at a Global Pride this year?
I did not know that. Learned my something new for today.
Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, Pride organizations from around the world have come together to produce Global Pride 2020. Join us as we go behind the scenes to find out what it's all about.
Global Pride is an initiative that kind of came together between a lot of Pride organizations around the world to try and keep a bit of Pride happening during the COVID-19 pandemic. So it's a partnership between InterPride, which is kind of an international body of Pride organizations, as well as the European Pride Organizers Association and several other networks around the world, who have all come together to organize a 24-hour online Pride celebration. I'm hot on the outside. Canada Pride is helping out with Global Pride, not only as content contributors, with all of the prides in Canada having the opportunity to submit something for the broadcast, but as well as organizers of the broadcast itself. So myself as a graphic designer and communications person, I've been helping out with doing a lot of the graphic and content work for Global Pride. And then we've got prides from across the country, including Fierté Capital Pride in Ottawa, Vancouver Pride, Calgary Pride, and then speakers and celebrity guests from Canada as well, including the Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau.
My friends, we've come a long way, but there's still so much more work to do to build a more open and inclusive world for everyone.
You know, personally, it's always, part of my passion to be working for our community in one way or another. I am the co-chair of my own Pride in Regina and sit on the national board with Fierté Canada Pride. Knowing that we're doing, you know, a project to be able to celebrate Pride during a pandemic, not only to, you know, provide entertainment and something for our community to gather around, but also to fundraise and provide support for the 500 plus prides that have had to cancel or postpone.
For Outlook TV, this is Angus Pratt in Vancouver.
Let's head on over to Victoria to hear about what's on for Pride this year.
I hear Kelly was on site to tell us all about it.
Hello, everyone, and happy Pride. That is virtual Pride here in Victoria. I'm getting ready to check out some of the virtual events, and then we're going to chat with some of the people who made it happen. Come join.
Right. Now, I therefore hereby proclaim June 28th to July 5th, 2020, as Pride Week.
Last year, the biggest concern was rain hitting the Pride stage. And this year it was, will there be a Pride festival of any kind? So different in that we shifted formats to an online platform. But the structure of the show stayed pretty much the same. So after we made the decision to make a virtual show was when the Black Lives Matter sort of flourishing, and a lot of performers were reaching out saying that they really weren't feeling comfortable sort of being the center of the spotlight, being a white performer, and just sort of roots back to the first Pride Parade again and how it was Black trans women who were really leading the way for us there. So we decided to turn it into a fundraiser for said organization, specifically a local one like Hogan's Alley Society in Vancouver.
What was that like for you, making a drag ball documentary this year?
I mean, it was fun. It was interesting to, like, to gather all the things and like hunt out people, you know, because as you know, like some people did, we didn't use all the material that we got because we were working on a timeline. And I was hesitant about it, like, I have to be honest. But when I finally saw it, I was so happy. It was so good. All my friends cried.
And I don't really know what's going on. Not in my heart, not in this dark and turbulent world, and certainly not on this show.
Emceeing virtually, like emceeing not live in the moment, the thing that I'm noticing today, my memories of doing it are not of being alone. So when I think about, oh, you know, the Pride festival that I just emceed, I don't envision myself in that room by myself with a camera in front of me. It's like the ghost of all the previous prides, all the body memory and all the feeling memory. It's all there in my head when I look back, but I wanted the pride to be its own space, and oddly not an intimate space, not a kitchen, not a bedroom. It needed to be its own special world, because that's kind of in a way what Pride Festival feels like to me. It's our own special world where we go to be together and celebrate.
It's been really exciting seeing what people were able to bring together for virtual Pride this year. I hope you have a happy Pride, however you're able to celebrate. This has been Kelly Legg with Outlook TV.
That's all the time we have for this episode of Outlook TV, but we will be back in front of you before you know it.
And if you miss us too much, well, you can find us on all of our social media platforms.
Everything except Grindr. We're not on Grindr.
Aren't we not? I thought we were.
No, that's you.
Oh, darn it.
Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Rebecca Wyman.
And I'm Ollie.
Stay safe, Canada.